The thin horizon of a plan is almost clear. My friends and I have had a tough time. We're losing our brains, hard up against change. All the old dogs and the magician. Now I see we're in the boat in two by twos. Only the heart that we have for a tool we can use. And the very close quarters are hard to get used to. Love weighs the hole down with its weight. But the wood is tired and the wood is old. And we'll make it fine if the weather holds. But if the weather holds, we'll miss the boat. That's where I need to. Construction of this tricky plan was built by other than a greater hand. With a love that passes all our understanding, watching closely over the journey. Yeah, and what it takes to cross the great divide seems more than all the courage I can muster up inside. But if we get to have some answers when we reach the other side, the prize is always worth the rocky ride.
But the wood is tired and the wood is old, and we'll make it fine if the weather holds. But if the weather holds, we'll have missed the point. That's where I need to go.
Sneak a closer look, skip to the final chapter of the book, and then maybe steer us clear from some of the pain that it took to get us where we are this far. Oh, but the question drowns in its futility, and even I have got to laugh. No one gets to miss the storm of what will be. Just holding on for the ride. And the wood is tired and the wood is old. And we'll make it fine if the weather holds. But if the weather holds, we'll have missed the point.
That's where I need to go.
Good morning and welcome to First Christian Church, a church that strives to embrace God's love and hospitality. So no matter who you are, no matter what brought you to the service this morning, we're glad you're here and we believe God loves you. That being said, we are gathering both in person and in a virtual space, so be aware of that, and a special welcome to our virtual participants this morning. As we move deeper into the service, a few things to be aware of. We will break bread later in the service. For those of you who are in the virtual space, grab whatever communion elements are meaningful to you. For those who are here in person, there's a little all-in-one communion cup that is quite tasty, I assure you. It's at the entrance to the sanctuary. If you didn't get that, make sure to grab that for later in the service. Also, if you have prayers you'd like us to include in our prayer life, feel free to use Facebook Live as a space to do that, and we'll try to incorporate those into the service. If you don't feel comfortable in that space, reach out to one of the leaders after the service and we'll make sure to include your prayers. Also, Nellie is meeting with the children's ministry program upstairs in the children's ministry room, but that is a hybrid approach. So if you're online and your children are online, that's also a space that they are welcome. Also, you'll see a table with candles on it. We set this up a few weeks ago to light candles, not only for peace, but for anything that might be happening in your life. So we invite you to come forward towards the end of the service during the closing song to utilize this space to light candles and offer prayers. Also, if you're joining us virtually, let us know on Facebook Live where you're joining us from. It reminds us that we remain connected during this most challenging and difficult time. Also, I return to the reminder that no matter how you enter this space, no matter what you believe about God, community, the church, how you define love, family, and even God, you are welcome in this space and embraced. I now invite you to stand as we join together in song.
Torn at the seams, it's getting harder and harder to see what any of this means. And hate is having its day, and children are shot in the streets. Sometimes there's no way, death has lost its sting. So broken, again and again we pray. Where has all the mercy gone? The writing's on the wall. We just wish that we could see. We want to close our face that we find. Pray that you are listening. God, forgive us one more time. Why are things so broken? Again and again we pray. Haven't seen, and ears haven't heard the kind of blessings that's about to fall on me. This victory is here. Kick defeat out the door. God's doing a new thing, yeah. Get ready for overflow. 'Cause I'm getting ready to see something I've never seen. I'm getting ready to see something. about to fall on me. Yeah, His victory is here. Kick defeat out the door. God's doing a new thing. Yeah, get ready for an overflow. Getting ready to see something I've never seen. Yes, I'm getting ready to see something I've never seen. Yes, I'm getting ready to see something I've never seen.
Please be seated. We've now entered that time in the service in which we offer prayers. Prayers for ourselves, prayers for those we know and love, and prayers for those we don't know. As I said before, if you have a prayer you'd like to share, please feel free to do that on Facebook Live or let one of the leaders know after worship, and we'll include your prayer in our prayer life. In a few moments, I will share the prayers from this community. After each prayer, I will say, God, in your mercy, I invite you to respond with the phrase, hear our prayers. So we begin by giving thanks for a complicated and life-giving community of faith that in imperfect ways strives to remain connected and be reminded of God's love. Let us give thanks for this community of faith. God, in your mercy. We also give thanks for our partners in ministry, like the Burbank Temporary Aid Center, where volunteers packed lunches in our upper fellowship hall yesterday that provides food for those who are food insecure. Let us give thanks for that ministry. God, in your mercy. We also hold in thought and prayer Robert Rojas and his family after Robert lost his mother this past week. May we surround their family with care, prayers, and love. Robert, Liz, and the rest of your family, you are in our thoughts and prayers. God, in your mercy. We also pray for Alex, a son of Tina, who was hospitalized this past week. May we hold them and their family in thought and prayer. God, in your mercy. We also pray for Denise, friend of Jeff and Jan, who is now in the ICU. May we keep Denise and her friends and family in prayer. God, in your mercy. We also have a special prayer request from Beverly, who's a virtual participant from Oklahoma. She asks that we pray for her daughter, who is preparing for open heart surgery, and her son, Danny, who is struggling with an addiction. God, in your mercy. We also pray for Catherine Engel's cousin, Diane Epting, who recently discovered her brain tumor is growing. May we hold her in prayer. God, in your mercy. We also continue to pray for the following people in our community who are facing some kind of medical uncertainty, such as Janine, Pam J., Carlos, Stan, Britt, Brian and Nancy, and Amy Hill. God, in your mercy. And for those who are visitors this day, we have been praying for several weeks for Ken, a member of our congregation who was hit by a car at the corner of 3rd and Olive. I have an update. Ken is starting to venture into physical therapy and recovery. He is committed to that, but can we continue to hold Ken and his entire family in thought and prayer? God, in your mercy. And with the reality of Ukraine in the headlines on a regular basis, it's an invitation to keep those who identify as refugees or are moving across this globe seeking safety and security and thought and prayer. And we are reminded that Ukrainians are not the only individuals or families seeking hospitality. There are countless individuals and families at a myriad of borders across the world seeking safety, love, and hope. May we hold them and our leaders in thought and prayer. God, in your mercy. And for those who aren't in person, we're going to give thanks for James today, who just ran up and gave us a little greeting and is coming back. We give thanks for children who might remind us of levity. Levity and love in all of its forms. So let's give thanks to God. God, in your mercy. We also pray for those who are unhoused and experiencing homelessness. As sweeps continue across LA County, let us pray for those communities and all those who seek to stand with and care for them. God, in your mercy. We also pray for the LGBTQ+ community as political and religious rhetoric heats up and causes marginalization, very real violence and damage. May we hold that community and their families in thought and prayer. God, in your mercy. Finally, we turn to the entire world and all of creation, recognizing that there are a number of people who log on to our service from around the world. Russia, Portugal, Korea, and so many other places. May we be reminded that God's kingdom is large and inclusive, and indeed embraces the myriad of people that call this planet home. May we hold in prayer this planet and all of God's children. God, in your mercy, let us continue this time with song.
Forgotten nor abandoned nor destroyed here. In all that is to come, may love be what sustains us as the earth begins to move and we question what our aim was. I can't promise to protect you at the dying of the light, but I will do one better. I will teach you how to fight. That neighbors could love neighbors and the poor here. I'm sorry I was wrong, didn't know the battle I was losing means much more here. In all that is to come, may love be what sustains us as the earth begins to move and we question what our aim was. I can't promise to protect you at the dying of the light. I will do one better. I will teach you how to fight. In all that is to come, we won't lose sight of kindness. We will be each other's hope. Surrounded by the blindness, I can't promise to protect you if the world should lose its sight. I will do one better. I will help you look for.
invite you to join me in a time of prayer. God of love and hospitality, you draw us into this space from a multitude of experiences. Have you heard us articulate our prayers this morning, God? You know that some come into this space with heavy grief and anxiety. We ask that you hold that. Some come into this space giving thanks for a number of things that happened this past week. We ask that you hold that as well. Some cautiously enter this space, asking whether or not they will be welcomed and loved. In the complexity of this time, God, remind us that we are welcomed and loved by you, and nothing can change that. God, we give thanks for the sound of children and the reminders of youth and the liveliness that that often brings. We give thanks for music that moves us beyond mere words into the mystery of your presence. We give thanks for this space and this time. And God, finally, we ask that as we enter this space, that you let us leave changed. We might be changed by your comfort and your stillness. We might be disrupted by calls to be more aware of your call for love and justice. We might be altered to more courageously step into this world to proclaim your love and truth. We might be changed because we are reminded that you hold, love, and embrace us. Regardless of where that change comes, continue to empower us to be your people and to walk courageously into this day. In your name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There, they gave him a dinner. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She brought it so that it might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me."
I invite you to join me in a time of prayer. God of ancient story and difficult words, open us this day to the mystery of your presence. In your name we pray. Amen. How dare she? How dare she walk into that room with her perfume, her ideas of God, of community, and of healing? How dare she do that? The story that Jan read this morning comes towards the end of Jesus' ministry, towards the end of John's gospel. The drama around Jesus of Nazareth's life is picking up. There are those of us who know how this story begins to unfold. We know what comes next. But the narrative arc of John, we're left, if we don't get to the end of the story, of this sense that an excitement is starting to build. A clash is going to happen something significant that will transform our very ideas of who God is and what community is called to be. And then we're placed right smack dab into the 12th chapter of John, verses 1 through 8. You're more than welcome to look that up online. And a woman by the name of Mary enters the space. And how dare she? That's the sense we get right away from the disciples that are surrounding her, which we are given the sense is a group of men, well established in the religious order, while marginalized in some way, still holding on to that sense that they were called to be in charge, they were called to interpret, they were called to understand, and others were simply invited to exist on the margins. How dare she? How dare she walk towards Jesus, as the story tells us, breaking open a bottle of perfume, anointing his body, and in a mysterious ritual, giving thanks for his legacy, his words, his healing, all that he embodied to her and revealed for her, and stepping away. How dare she? And then in a moment of dramatic surprise, we are reintroduced to the character of Judas Iscariot, who calls into question her very presence. And in a sweeping moment, Jesus dismisses that critique, and with a phrase that is echoed through the ages and haunted the church, says, "The poor will always be with you." Now, on surface, this story is complicated, as many gospel stories are, and carries all kinds of phrases and triggers in it. And so this morning, I'm going to spend some time with some of those phrases, but also digging in to the audacious nature of this one we call Mary, who challenges, upends, and finally reveals a mere fraction of who God is and who we're called to be. What was she doing there? What was she carrying? And what kind of theological truths was she revealing? What she began to participate in, the words of biblical scholars, would be a burial ritual. That perfume that she broke open would have been saved for days, weeks later, when a grief-stricken group of disciples would have been left questioning what had happened, what had gone wrong. And that ointment would have been used as a balm for Jesus' body and for those disciples who were grieving. But she, in that moment, and in the way the gospel writer of John tells us, is she reveals that in her audacious strength and nature knows what is going to transpire. She, in her wisdom, strength, and courage, knows the story that is unfolding among her. She has a knowledge and a sense of what comes next, the knowledge and wisdom that those disciples don't seem to have. I want to remind you that time and again in the Gospels, that group of 12 disciples is constantly depicted as the group that has no clue. They've been told time and again what is going on, but time and again that group is left without the knowledge, the insight, the theological curiosity to understand God's unfolding story. But in this story, it's Mary who knows. It's Mary who carries the wisdom. It's Mary with the knowledge. How dare she have that? It must have burned Judas to the core. It must have unnerved Peter and the other disciples to think that they weren't the keepers of that knowledge and that information. And so there we get to the theological layer, the first in this story.
is that God's wisdom and presence is often revealed, unveiled in those who we least to suspect it to happen. And in that first century context, it was Mary, a woman who was often pushed to the edges and to the margins of society, who was least likely to be expected to have that knowledge and that information. But what this gospel story tells us, instead of her being at the edge of the story, should be placed at the center of it. That instead of those who are traditionally pushed to the margins, are rather becoming the center of the gospel story. Those who experience systems of oppression and marginalization are no longer at the edges, but indeed become the very source of knowledge, theological truth, and God's love. I'm going to let you sit with that for a moment. Those who are traditionally pushed to the margins and the edges aren't just welcomed in, but become the very center and theological focus of God's unfolding story of love and truth. For those who have been traditionally marginalized by the church, pushed to the edges, this is an audacious story. This is a profound claim and stretches our understanding of welcome itself. That it's not just about welcoming in and broadening our idea of community, but rather it's placing at the center the stories and experiences of those who have been traditionally pushed out and marginalized. Not just finding a place for them at this table, but truly listening to their stories and putting those stories of hurt, pain, grief, isolation, joy, thanksgiving, those things become the center of who we are and God's truth. So there might be those of you in this space and virtually this morning who walk into religious communities or social institutions thinking and having the experiences that I have been pushed out. I have been pushed to the edge. I am not welcome. What this story teaches us is something radically different. Is as the Christian community and a religious community begins to and continues to construct itself, we hope your story, your experience becomes the center of who we are and how we understand God. For as Mary walked into that very dangerous room and space that day, her breaking of that perfume bottle and her lifting up that experience taught us a fundamental lesson in truth. As that in the imperfect nature of who we are called to center and focus ourselves on that kind of story, that kind of experience. And there are theologians and biblical scholars that invite us into that kind of truth and theological understanding. I'm going to throw a name out for you and invite you to look up that name when you have time. Kwok Pui Lan. K-W-O-K-P-U-I-L-A-N. Kwok Pui Lan. She's a post-colonial feminist theologian. That's a lot of words all at once. But in her theological reflection and her understanding, this is the very thing she teaches. Is that those who have been traditionally marginalized and pushed out are called to be at the center of this kind of gospel, God-centered, God-revealed community. Kwok Pui Lan talks about her history as an Asian woman and the damaging effects of colonialism, which has been experienced around the world. And in her theological reflection, she talks about how we must, as people of faith, have the courage to interrogate those structures and that kind of damage, and the ways in which the church has unfortunately aligned itself with it. But then, after interrogating those structures, we then reorient ourselves so that our liturgies, our sermons, our prayers, our community gatherings, all of who we are, recenters ourselves on those stories of vulnerability, deep trauma, and marginalization. So we, as a community of faith, are better equipped and able to be a space of safety, courage, love, and strength, the very things that God calls us to be about in this world. Kwok Pui Lon was a Mary, is a Mary. She has been questioned by theologians and other leaders of the church. How dare Kwok Pui Lon ask us to reorient ourselves or to be aware of voices on the edges? How dare she question colonization and the dangerous effects of it? How dare she take her story and invite it to be the center of who we are and what we're becoming? But she stands in a long tradition of Marys that push back and stand up to say my story, their story, is part of God's story. Whether it's the refugee that has carefully made his or her way to the United States and is looking for a place of hospitality, that story is important. Whether it's the LGBTQ plus person who carries the scars of a tradition that has consistently and constantly pushed them out, they are a Mary when they stand up and walk through our doors. Whether it's somebody who identifies as an evangelical that has been hurt and burdened by the church, and they have the courage and audacity to try to find a place where they're finally embraced and call home, they're a Mary, breaking their bottle of perfume open, revealing God's truth and God's love in its fullest form. So we return to that. How dare they? And reverse that question to us. How dare we not take that theological truth and claim and make it the center of who we are and who we are becoming? Refocus ourselves, realign ourselves, and broaden our understanding of story, of truth, of God's grace, and God's community. Thanks be to God for the audacious and courageous Marys who time and time again draw our attention to God's love, God's truth, and God's power, and how we are called to reorient our lives to them, to those Marys, to those people, and to those stories. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning. The scripture today describes Mary using valuable perfume to anoint Jesus. She did not stop to think about how others might view this, but followed her heart and did what she thought was most important and meaningful in the moment. It was not well received by everyone present, but it had a lasting impact in the end. Perhaps this is what makes other women in religious and political history so controversial. The women who changed history are those who were brave enough to stand up for what they deeply believed in or for what they knew was right. They did not take an easy path, but carved one for themselves and all those who have followed. These women have stood up when they were expected to sit down, spoken up when they were expected to be quiet, and they trusted that their voice would be loud enough for the world to hear. They changed religious, political, and societal norms by being true and faithful in their endeavors. Elizabeth Ann Seton was a philanthropist and founded the Sisters of Charity and opened a school for girls. She was the first American to be canonized as a saint by the Roman Catholic Church. Pastor and author Victoria Lores, who started the Church of the Wild in Ojai, believes and preaches that we should include the natural world along our spiritual journeys. Her Eminence Mindralning Jesun Khandro Rinpoche is one of the very few female Tibetan Buddhist precious masters. Margaret Higgins Sanger was an American political activist and nurse. She helped to open the first clinic in the United States that evolved into Planned Parenthood. Mary Tape was a Chinese immigrant who ran away from a brothel. She later married, and her husband became successful business owners. They sued the San Francisco Board of Education for not allowing their daughter to go to public school. Laura Cornelius Kellogg was an activist and author and helped to found the Society of American Indians. She fought the government policies that stripped the Native Americans of their languages, cultures, and societies. Ruth Bader Ginsburg became the second female justice of the United States Supreme Court. She fought for gender equality her entire life. Malala Yousafzai was shot by the Taliban for standing up for the education of girls in Pakistan. Vice President Kamala Harris is the first African American, the first woman vice president of our country. Perhaps by looking back at how so many women, and men of course, have stood up for what was right, have lived a faithful life, and have changed the way that people view the world around them, we too can be inspired to do this as individuals and as a church community. I am always so impressed when I get to know people more at church and find out more about their struggles and their triumphs. Our church members are so unique and extraordinary, and I am happy that this is what makes us so diverse and also so compassionate. May we prepare to gather around the table to take communion, knowing that we are all invited and welcome, and may we go out into the world inspired to perhaps make a few waves for good. RBG said, "Whatever you choose to do, leave tracks." That means don't just do it for yourself. You will want to leave the world a little better for your having lived.
We gather to rehearse a long-held tradition. In a moment, Brendan and I will say the words of institution and we will take the bread together. We will refrain from partaking in the cup until after I lead us in the Lord's Prayer. Please remember that you are welcome at this table no matter what you believe about the bread, cup, or the presence of God. When Jesus was gathered with his closest friend, he took the loaf of bread, broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us take the bread together.
And in a similar way, he took a cup, and after giving thanks, poured it out, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant. Each time you do this in remembrance of me."
People use many words to refer to God. Some include Creator, Mother, Father, and Sustainer. As we say the Lord's Prayer together, whether you're at home watching on Facebook Live or here at the sanctuary, please use the name of God and phrases in the Lord's Prayer that comfort you and sustain your prayer life. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not let us fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. That brings us to our announcements part of this service. First Christian Church is working very hard. Our staff is working very hard behind the scenes to keep our weekly and monthly events ongoing, as well as many upcoming events that are going to be happening in the future. But the question is, how does all this happen? Like, what's behind the curtain? How does it work? What are the inner workings of this mechanism? Well, you want to know a little secret? It's you. Because all of you of helping with your inner either volunteering or any donations, it helps this church keep going and helps our staff keep working hard to make this possible and keep our community growing and vibrant. But how does this, how do I donate, Todd? That's a great question. Thank you for asking. I love these questions. First, you can go the very futuristic route where we have a, if you're on Facebook Live, we have a QR code you can scan with your phone. Ah, 2022, the future, truly magnificent. That's how you can do it one way. Or you can go the classic way. You can go to our website and click on the Give Now button, and it will take you right there. You can click Give, and it will take you right to it, and you can do that. That's very easy. Just no little keyboards. Or you can go the analog, the retro giving way, we call it, by sending in through snail mail or just dropping it off by the office in an envelope. And with that, I'll turn it over to Brandon for announcements.
Thank you, Todd. always great. We do have a number of opportunities to engage in our ministry and life together. With the number of visitors we have today, I want to say if you have any questions about our service, the language we use, or the flow of our service, please reach out to us or our leadership, and we can fill you in and attempt to answer any of your questions. That being said, we do have opportunities to engage in this ministry. We have weekly programming, such as a study on Wednesday evenings at 7 p.m., and a weekly reflection group on Thursday at 8 p.m. Both of those opportunities are on Zoom, so you don't have to be in person to partake. Also, on Thursday mornings and early afternoons, we have a group called Homemade Thursdays that prepares and then delivers food to those living in the encampments. If you want more information about any of those opportunities, please see our weekly email that usually goes out on Tuesdays. Also, this Sunday at 1 p.m., as in today, we have an anti-racism and pro-reconciliation training on Zoom in which we're going to interrogate things like white supremacy, anti-racism work, and talk about practical tools to deal with some of that. If you want more information or the link to that opportunity, please reach out to me and I'll make sure you're included. Also, the third Saturday of every month, we have a hiking group that meets here in our parking lot at 9 a.m. If you want information about that or want to join that group, reach out to me. Also, I'm going to turn it over to Britt to explain about another group that meets on a regular basis.
Yeah, thanks, Brandon. We also have a LGBTQ fellowship group, which meets sort of at a predetermined Sunday each month. And for this month, I think it's going to be the third or the fourth Sunday. So if you're part of the queer community and you want to come to that, let me know if the third or fourth Sunday works best for you. I think this is a five-Sunday month, so I'm talking about like the not the last one, but the ones just before it. So we use that space to come together in fellowship. Often we'll just eat a meal together. But we also recently have been studying and using some papers to kind of look at how liberation theology can help us deconstruct the harmful messages around colonization, the patriarchy, capitalism that have impacted our community as well as other marginalized groups. So if you want to talk about that stuff, feel free to come join us. If you want to just have lunch and hang out, that's what we're going to be doing next month. So there's options for everybody. Thank you, Brandon.
Thanks, Britt. Hanging out with you for lunch sounds like a great opportunity. Again, all of these things are in our weekly email that go out on they go out on Tuesday. If you want more information or want to be included in that list, let us know. There are a number of opportunities, and we'll leave it at that. I'm going to turn it over to our incredibly gifted musicians as we stand, as we are able, and join together in song.
I don't believe in fairy tales. I guess I've outgrown them. But that doesn't mean I don't believe that there's something bigger than me. 'Cause I've seen it in a hospital room. And the doctor said, sorry, there's nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't. I'd never seen a pot of gold at the end of a rainbow. But I've got a promise I can hold in my love the struggle. God, if you say goodness, I'll trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you.
I know you've ordered every step. Yeah, you are the author. There's no predicting what is next, but you hold the future. And all the questions, they come second to the one that I know is true. You've always been true.
I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you.
Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all persons. Honor all creation. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the love of God, the light of Christ, and the power and communion of that Spirit be with each and every one of us. Let us go in peace. Amen.